these wonderful ladies. Guys, my name is Jonathan. I am thankfully part of SA Mastermind. It was an idea of one of our panel members to get a group of different entrepreneur business owners together that could help counsel, coach, and be a part of your guidance also. And this is obviously the very first SA Women's Mastermind that we're putting on. We are so incredibly blessed and thankful to have the women that are here to speak to you tonight. And without further ado, I'd like to ask you all to please stand up and welcome our panel members. Thank you very much. What an incredible welcome. I wish I'm going to give this to you, Nurse, because you'll have that next. As I was saying, my name is Jonathan De La Garza. I am a local entrepreneur and realtor, and when I was asked if I wanted to be part of SA Mastermind, I instantly said yes, because not only did I feel that I had something that I could share, I also felt that there was a lot that I could learn. And putting on these events has helped me learn so much from so many different people, not only the people on stage, but the audience members who we have a chance to connect with afterwards. I'm always learning from people, and I'm actually super, super excited to be joined with Rachel Blondie Jones from 94.1 KTFM as our fellow MC. So Rachel, please give her a big round of applause.
Thank you, guys. I've only lived in Texas for about a year and a half, and I love the culture. I love the food. I love learning, and that's why I'm here. I know that sounds very cliche, but I love learning. And not just books, like learning like in classrooms, but I love learning from people. And I've known Nerissa for a good while, and I've learned so much from her, and I've been very motivated with her. And I'm very honored and proud to be a part of this event and to be surrounded, not to just learn from you women up here, but to learn from everyone as you guys are here. So I'm very, very thankful for that.
Well, we're glad to have you. How often do we get a celebrity here? So thank you very much.
We don't make that much money in radio, so we're not celebrities. But thank you, Jonathan.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is the agenda for tonight. Hopefully you guys did some networking. Hopefully you met some people that you haven't met yet. And if you haven't, we're going to take an intermission. So please feel free to network. What's that great saying that you never learn anything talking to yourself? So you can always learn something talking to someone else. Now, if you'll notice on your tables, there are some index cards. We encourage you to write down any questions that you have for the panel members, because after the intermission, you're going to get a chance to have your questions answered by our panel members. So Nerissa is going to come up, do a short presentation. Then we're going to have our panel members speak on some of their successes and challenges being a female entrepreneur. And as we've said from the beginning, this obviously the seminar is not just for women, it's for men also, because the principles that they share about success are universal. We're going to have an intermission, we'll do our Q&A session and then our closing announcements. And then, if you were lucky enough to get one of the VIP seats, you're going to have a chance to actually come and mingle with them in the room afterwards. So once again, thank you very, very much for being part of this. And I would like to ask Nerissa, our one of our founding members, to come up and tell us why this was important to you. Because, I mean, before you get up, this was important to me, because early on we knew we were going to want to do an event like this that targeted women, because women, it's no surprise that men in this world make more than women. These women here are an exception that probably make more than a lot of men, but it's, you know, women typically sometimes make less than men. So it's good to have these women up here to share some of their principles. So Nerissa, I'm glad to be a part of this and glad to have our first SA Women's Empowering Mastermind. So tell us why it was important for you to do this.
Yes, sorry to interrupt you. Sorry, girl power here. We don't give a big shout out to our sponsors tonight, though. We got Welcome Home Magazine. Big applause for you guys, Welcome Home Magazine. Tacos and Salsa, or is this to the right or to the left? Oh, there we are. Then we got Cassandra's Collections. Where are you guys at? Cassandra's Collections, there you are. Go Eat Right, is it you guys? Go Eat Right, yeah. Then we got HKD Custom Designs. There you go, feeling all sophisticated. So big shout out. Thank you guys so much for being our sponsor tonight. And we couldn't do this event without you guys. Truly, truly, truly. So, Marissa, do you want to take it from now?
Thank you, Blondie. Thank you, Jonathan, so much. Thank you guys again for being here and coming. I know the weather was a little icky and the traffic was bad, but when you really want to do something, when you really want to learn something, you want to be a part of it and you're going to find a way. I was just talking to someone about that today, that you find a way to do what you really want to do. And this event was important to me. As many of you know, I'm part of the Mastermind, but I was determined, and they probably know this, my other panel members, I was determined to wanting to do a great event with women, for women, and men. Because, again, we learn from all, not just men, not just women. We learn from each other. And the biggest thing about women's equality is not to say that men are holding us down, but it's to say that we should all be working together and growing together and helping each other. So that's why this was so important to me, as I noticed through the different areas I've been in business. I've worked for the military. I've been in corporate wellness. So I've seen all facets as far as men and women working together. And I think there's definitely some areas we all need to work on as men and women, but a few things that I did want to touch on, without a doubt. And this is just a little, you know, Oprah, one of the things I always tell myself is to, you know, read, watch, whatever it is, people that are going to help to encourage you, motivate you, someone you can learn from, someone who's positive. Because obviously if you hang out with someone that's negative, it's going to bring you down. And we all know that. When someone brings their black cloud around you, it doesn't help. It brings you down. So we don't want that. Okay, so this is 2015. Just some pointers I wanted to show you guys. On average, women make 78 cents for every dollar that a man earns. Okay? So keep those things in mind. Asian women make 90% as compared to white men. White women, 78%. African American women, 64%. Hispanic women, 54%. And here's some other ones. We only have 4.6 of women that hold CEO positions in the Fortune 500. And if a lot of the stats and some of the things I'm going to mention come from, you guys know that Think and Grow Rich by Napoleon Hill. They have a Think and Grow Rich for women, okay? And a lot of times, for example, these events, you may think, why do we have to have a separate one for women? It's not that the rules of success are different, as they explain it in the book, it's that we view success in a different way. We approach the rules of success in a different manner. So that's going to be the biggest reason. So for example, success, from what they read, to a man, may be a big promotion with a lot more money, or the best parking spot, right? And then for women, they said the number one reason that they leave jobs is they don't feel valued. And that's probably going to be in a lot of areas. So that's why it was important for, again, for men to also learn these things, because that's the number one feeling of success for women, is when they feel valued. Of course, we all want a higher pay, a higher salary, but of course to know that our work and all the effort that we put into something is valued, appreciated. And that probably goes for all areas of our life, business and personal. So again, that was a little surprising to me, and only 14.6% of executive officer positions among Fortune 500, right? So we have to keep those things in mind. And as women, a lot of times, sometimes we are intimidated. Like if many of you heard, how many of you heard about the Jennifer Lawrence story about when she went to, how she made less money than her male counterparts? And what she said was that she blames herself. And the reason why is when she goes to the office and sits down to negotiate, she didn't want to sound greedy. She didn't want to sound like she was asking for too much. She felt bad. Instead of saying, this is what I'm worth. So you always have to remind yourself of what you're worth, all the work you put into something. Someone may say, it only took you 5 minutes to do that. You may say, yes, but think of all the learning and education experience that it took to get to where that I am today. So we have to remember that. And if you've also ever heard of the book Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg, one of the things that she brings up, and I may use a slightly foul word here, but a lot of times when women give their opinion, I have a close friend, a very dear friend, that she has a very high position in a company, major corporation that's international, was on Forbes top 10. And because she has to be firm in her decisions in the position she's in, she has told me that sometimes people look at her and think, she's the B word. Sounds like witch, and they've even said she's probably like that at home and so forth and, you know, yada, yada, yada. And actually she's a mentor to me. She is a close friend. And I can't help but look to her sometimes when I go or need advice. And she's wonderful. But the thing is, when you have to make decisions at work or about your work, you're going to have to sometimes stand firm and voice your opinion. And unfortunately, sometimes people may say, oh, she's in a bad mood, or, you know, she's acting kind of moody, or she's not having a good day. And I think as women, how many of us have been there? Yes? Anyone else? Like, oh my, and I won't say some other ones because it may. But I mean, again, it's all stuff that we run into and that unfortunately women have to deal with on a regular basis as far as work is concerned. Whether we work for someone, with someone, or for ourselves, when we have to stand firm sometimes, right away, some people, not everyone, are going to be label you as being opinionated or moody. Okay? So keep that in mind. This is a cute little video because I know some of the facts too that I have to bring up. Some of us are mothers as well. So not only do we deal with what we do at home or at work, but when we get home, does our job stop? We start our second job, correct? It doesn't stop. And dads too. But women, you know, a lot of times as mothers tend to be the nurturers and so forth. So this is a cute little video that I thought, it's a trailer. And I absolutely love this movie. And if you've seen it, you'll know why I like it so much, so.
A recent study showed that women with young children don't sleep through the night. Researchers were at a loss to explain why. They could have asked me. Instead of sleeping, I do the list. Number one.
Take out late to school. I am just so jealous. You get to look nice all day and you just run around at the park.
Number two.
Keep my head above water at work.
Turn from the boy as well. I have two choices here. The man's excuse, bad traffic, down power lines, faulty carburetor, or mammogram.
Oh.
Number three, spend more time with nature.
You must be completely exhausted.
Not completely. Number four, kids. Kindergarten bake sale. Christmas lights. Birthday party. I don't know how you do it.
I don't know how you do it.
I don't know how she does it. All those children.
I have two.
So impressive.
You have four.
Yeah, two of mine are twins.
Jack Abraham in our New York office has his bar to a proposal and he'd like to meet the author. Long enough, but go ahead. If there's anything else you need to adjust,
this could be a big step up. Gives your kids a chance to spend all that extra quality time they didn't have before. Your nanny.
Did you take Ben to get his haircut?
Yeah.
Oh, that was his first haircut.
First haircut.
Sorry. You okay?
Yep. I just kept picturing little tiny balls falling out of my hair into his inbox.
Although
sometimes I wish I didn't love it so much.
Go out to this joy.
I need somebody to gather your friends. We can't go on like this.
We can't go on like this. What do you think about not having to worry about priorities all the time?
again, it kind of gives you an idea sometimes of what, especially what the working mother has to deal with, but even women in general, whether you're working, whether you're at home, I know plenty of stay-at-home moms that I will not say they're not working moms. They are full-time working moms, which I think is the hardest job on the planet. Okay, is my friend Angela here? Did she make it? She said she was gonna try to make it, but I have a good friend named Angela. She has six kids. She came to me 3 months ago, and she's about to do her first fitness competition. She finally wanted to do something for herself, push herself, motivate herself, and she'll be competing this month. So again, you can't tell me when a mom has children and she's at home, she's not working. She is working. And not only handling her own schedule, but her children's schedule as well, and the household schedule, everyone's schedule. All right? So keep those things in mind, but again, I wanted to go over other few things. As I said, that video, it's called How She Does It, and it's with Sarah Jessica Parker. It's an older movie, so if you're wanting to get it, it may be on Netflix, but it's fantastic. I highly encourage it. So don't underestimate the strength in women, and as women, we shouldn't underestimate that either. And I think we could all use it to our advantage. And again, these stats were taken from Think and Grow Rich for Women. And it's 60% of all personal wealth held by women in the U.S. So 60% of wealth in the U.S. is held by women. I know you're like, no, but yes, okay? 85% of all consumer purchases in the U.S. are made by women. That I believe. Shopping! We got jewelry back there. We got clothes over there. So, that I believe. Globally, in 2013, women were responsible for $20 trillion in spending. $20 trillion. That was in 2013. It was estimated that by the end of 2014, it was going to be $28 trillion. $28 trillion spent by women. So, again, something I definitely believe. So, as I was discussing earlier, only 4.6 of CEOs are women in the Fortune 500. But look at this. Companies with most women directors attained a higher return on equity than those with the least by 53%. Okay, so there is something to be said when you look at statistics like that. There is strength within us, there is strength among us, and when we all work together as men and women, we can accomplish so much more. Not only at work, at home, with clients, always keeping an open mind and treat each other the same, always. So I think looking at those stats, we can definitely agree that we're strong. And I want all of us to give ourselves a round of applause. All the ladies. Like I said, we work hard to spend that money. Alright. So, this is another slide because one of the things I also wanted to talk about was, again, I go back to the Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg and some other speakers. I love being around, watching videos. Put yourself around people that are going to, again, support you, motivate you. Watch videos. Watch motivational videos on YouTube. There's so many. There's Oprah. There's Sheryl Sandberg. There's so many other ones. There's Victoria Osteen as well. But listen to things, read things, be around people, and other women that are going to have similar lives. Because unfortunately today, and unfortunately in the time of social media, we get so caught up with that. That we forget what we're supposed to be doing, what we're supposed to be focusing on, okay? And also to know that, as I was going to mention, we don't have to be perfect. Sometimes we want the perfect balanced life. It's not that we can have a completely balanced life, it's just we may have it at different times during our life. So one area may be going great, another area may not be. One area may be going great later, and that's how it goes. And not to beat yourself up over mistakes. Not to beat yourself up if you fall off track. Get back on track. It's so much easier for someone to put someone else maybe down or maybe criticize, but at the same time, you've got to focus on you and everything you're capable of. Like I said, you have to know your worth. And as women, we not only, and again, but we do have to compete with men, but as women, we have to stop competing with each other. We need to start working together. Part of the reason some of these stats exist is because, for example, one of the statistics was 80% of men apply for promotions, maybe a higher position, but 80% of men share that with other men. Only 17% of women share that with other women. So we should be pushing each other and helping each other, not maybe critiquing, not wondering, why did she get it and not me? Always looking to improve yourself and learn. And maybe you may be wondering why someone received a promotion or got the big account and maybe you didn't. But it always comes back to you, and that's a big part of the mastermind principle, is focusing on your goals and working together to grow. Okay? So with the concept of we can't be perfect, without a doubt, I know I'm not perfect. In this video alone, I can't tell you how many of these I can relate to. So I'm going to show y'all this real quick.
Show that, because remember,
remember, you don't have to be perfect. You have to be you and just believe in yourself, ladies, and help each other out. Thank you.
Thank you, Marissa. Big shout out to all the men that are here tonight. I swear this is not a man bashing event. Like Narissa said, though, this is all about us women coming together and motivating each other. It's not about, you know, competing against each other and learning from each other. With that said, Narissa, I'm going to make you talk again and talk about some sponsors here. Can we talk about some tacos and salsa?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. I know they had to leave a little bit early, but tacos and salsa is absolutely delicious. They are one of our sponsors. They were right over here. They are off 1604. So if you go to the 5123 North Loop 1604 West Plaza, it's right off the Lockville Selma overhead off 1604. They have delicious, delicious food, but they also have very healthy choices too. Yes, because I go there and I have their chicken tacos and they have some delicious salads. So I highly recommend them. We really appreciated them being here.
Thank you. Thank you, tacos and salsa. Do we have Cassandra here from Cassandra's Collections? Cassandra?
Yes, Cassandra, please come up and...
Cassandra!
Now, as she's making her way up here, she makes custom jewelry that is absolutely phenomenal. Whenever my girlfriend and I go out, she is always approached by ladies saying, where do you get your jewelry? Because it's all handmade. I'm going to let her explain. But before she gets up here, she made these awesome cufflinks for me. She makes men's jewelry too. So, Cassie, please tell us about how awesome your jewelry is.
Thank you, guys. Hi, everyone. I'm really happy to be here tonight. 8 years ago, I was a journalist for a women's business magazine in Dallas. And all the women that I interviewed actually really inspired me to pursue my jewelry career once I started it. I moved to New York 6 years ago.
Get on stage, girl. Come on.
Come on!
Get on up there.
I moved to New York 6 years ago, and I just returned back to Texas in April. So it's just been really nice, the welcoming home by all my friends and family, and just being able to do all of these events here in San Antonio and in Austin. But my jewelry is really special to me. I'm a one-woman shop. I make everything and sell everything and photograph everything. So each piece is really special, and I think that's something that every woman really likes, is something that's one of a kind. So please come back and see my pieces. Holidays are coming up, so it's a great gift to give for Christmas. And
she also donated a raffle item, so if you have not put your card in the fishbowl, you need to, because she's going to donate a...
It's a long, plain necklace that can also be doubled, similar to this, but with a little... Harry pendant. I know that means nothing to a lot of you, but
it means
men, that's a perfect gift.
It is awesome.
Exactly.
Yes. Awesome.
Thank you. Won't add to the trillions.
Yes, thank you, Cassie. Thank you very much.
Yes, our third sponsor is Kristen from Welcome Home Magazine. Kristen, girl, where you at? Kristen, come on up.
One on all of y'all's tables. So we're a direct mail community newspaper that's been in the Stone Oak and surrounding areas for the last 16 years. We target mostly on nonprofit organizations. We also target small businesses and schools, and we highlight outstanding students. So feel free to look through us. We do sell advertising. We're associated with the Stone Oak Business Association and a nonprofit organization called Living Through Giving. So we would love to have you guys give us a call and let us teach you how to expand your business in these areas. And thanks for letting us sponsor tonight, Mastermind Group. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Kristen.
Thank you, Welcome Home Magazine.
Well, I'm very excited about our first speaker. But before we do that, I just want to tell you guys that the whole genesis of the SA Mastermind thing was a principle by a gentleman named Napoleon Hill. He wrote a book called Think and Grow Rich. And in this book has changed so many people's lives. And he talks about the Mastermind Principle. For those of you who aren't aware or familiar with the Mastermind Principle, it equates the mind of a man to, or a woman, to a battery. And just as a battery will produce a certain amount of energy, a group of batteries will produce more energy and more efficiently. That makes sense, right? So his principle is that a group of minds together will create more energy more efficiently. And without a doubt, the people that he interviewed have proven this. Can you imagine getting into a room with these four ladies and them brainstorming and advising you on your business? Would you achieve more than sitting in a room by yourself? Absolutely, without question. So if anybody's interested in one of these books, we have them for sale back there. They're $10, and it's an incredible book. And if you buy it, I'm sure these ladies will happily autograph it for you. So let us know. And as I said, the first speaker that we want to introduce, I'm very excited about it because I am also a real estate broker. So I am looking forward to hearing what this lady has to say because she's all over the place. I can't tell you an event that I go to where I don't see one of her realtors there with her badges, Patricia's are. So please tell us some success principles.
Little bit about me, I was born and raised in San Antonio and was here most of my life. I did move away in high school, moved to Alabama, which is where I met Lane. And we stayed there through high school, through college, went to Auburn University, and then came back here in 2000. And I come from a family of entrepreneurs. You know, I don't know if y'all heard in town of Gary Pools or Pete Sarr's Pools. Those are both my family. And I think it was just in my blood to, you know, get out and do my own thing. So Lane had started in real estate in 2002, and I followed in 2003. I did new construction sales where he was actually in general real estate, and I knew pretty early on that I felt very limited in new construction sales because I was in one place. I couldn't quite give my clients or the customers coming through the door what they were looking for a lot of the time. And so I felt limited, and I knew that I wanted to do something a little bit more and, you know, be able to broaden the spectrum so that I could help more people. And so in 2011, I actually left new construction sales, joined up with him officially full-time, all of our eggs in one basket, which was really exciting. We started branding Czars and Rogers Realtors and spent a couple years just really focusing on, you know, our systems and trying to get our brand out there because we were a completely unknown brand in San Antonio. And so, you know, we did that for a couple of years. Obviously, we were still practicing in real estate too so that we could pay the bills and do everything we needed to with that. But a couple of years into it, we started bringing on agents, and we've got a team of nearly 60 now. So I don't have kids yet, but every now and then I feel like I have about 58 of them. Today, but you know, it's just a very interesting thing when you go out on your own. There's a lot of different things that go into it, and you know, as a woman or as a man, you know, you've got to work really, really hard, you know, and so it's one of those things that you got to figure out what your niche is going to be and, you know, how you're going to do things differently, not necessarily reinventing the wheel, you know, but doing things differently, doing them better, standing out, you know. So I was kind of soul searching, trying to figure out where do I want to focus? What do I want to do? And a couple years ago, I started doing a lot more of charity work. I got real involved with philanthropy. I know there's a table back in the back with the Ferrari Kid organization. I recently accepted a position on the executive board of directors with the Ferrari Kid. Every year we also do Sand Ministries fundraisers. We do the Food Bank. We do Habitat for Humanity. I ran for Woman of the Year with Leukemia Lymphoma Society last year. Actually, it was the year before last. But I found myself in a position with the company where I had a platform, you know, so I could get out there and I could, you know, raise awareness for these things and I could help raise funds and I could, you know, bring people together just by other things that we were doing and then help someone else. And that ultimately led me to where I think kind of my aha moment was with what I wanted to do. And it was, I wanted to make other people successful. So I wanted my success to come from making other people successful. And once I made that revelation and I decided that was going to be my focus, everything in my business changed. Everything I focused on, my time, my energy was completely different because I would stop and say, how's this going to make someone else successful? What is someone else going to learn from this? What can they get from this? So I'm super excited and honored that I was asked to be here today, and I do hope that either from something I say or from one of the other panelists that you just get
even just one little thing from what we say up here, and you know, one little extra bit of hope, extra bit of inspiration to, you know, help you on whatever journey to success that you find your passion in. So thanks for coming out.
Wait, before you go, I have a question. Okay, yes. So when you got your, what inspired you to become a realtor?
I was actually, when I moved back to San Antonio, I was working for my dad in the swimming pool business, and you know, so I had been back here about a year. Lane had gotten into real estate and was just out, you know, it was more of a, I didn't want a ceiling, you know, I didn't want a ceiling where I was. I wanted to, you know, that every effort or everything that I went out and did was going to just raise, you know, whatever it was I was doing or whatever else I was, you know, striving for that much more. So I didn't want to feel like I had a ceiling, and I wanted to make a difference, you know, and I think just that knowing that I didn't have, you know, to stop, you know, knowing that if I got up, if I spent one more hour every day doing something, or if I made one more call or did one more thing, that it would exponentially grow whatever I was working on. So it was just a drive and a passion to get out and take it as far as you can take it. So
that's awesome. I have to tell you, she just said something that I find awe-inspiring, something you don't hear every day. I want my success to be built on making other people successful. That's the kind of quality people that we need to surround ourselves with. Thank you very much for being a part of this. Don't forget, write your questions down. We'll be picking those up later to give a specific question for Patricia.
Yes, we'd like to introduce our next speaker, Veronica. By the way, I need to talk to you later because you're supposed to be doing my highlights. Veronica Luga Bass, she is the owner of Veronica Salon and Spa, which is a very successful business in our community. So I'll just take it away, girl.
Thank you for being here tonight. My name is Veronica Bass. I'm originally from Zacatecas, Mexico, and I've been here in San Antonio a little bit over 20 years. And I've always done my passion. The only thing that I've ever done is hair. But I knew that since I was a little girl, that was going to be my passion. And I knew, I believed in myself, and I knew that I was going to have my own place one day because that's all I've ever done. And I worked for a company for about 15 years, and I treated it like my place because, again, my passion was what I did, and I always gave it 100% with the work ethic that my daddy taught us. I knew that I was going to be successful one day. So I had my kids, with my wonderful husband, Cleon Bass, with his support, we decided after we had our third child to go ahead and open up my business, which is Veronica's Color Salon and Spa over here in Stone Oak area. And I have a team of 25 stylists. They're all wonderful, and I know that I need them as much as they need me. So I like to help people grow also, and hopefully they go on and do their own thing. Like my cousin's here now, and she went ahead and did her own little thing recently. And that's what I like to see, successful people. I think that there's enough people in the world to go around to share your success. So we should not be jealous as women. Like you said, we should empower other women, always help each other out. And just remember that when you have passion for what you do, that equals success. So you just gotta love what you do, passion, and with God, you know, you can do anything when you believe in yourself. That's first of all, and then passion and hard work. It's gonna take hard work, it's not easy, but when you love what you do, it's not work. So you just gotta give it 100% and the rest is history. So thank you for being here.
Well, I have a question. So you also said something that I hear a lot of very successful people say, and they attribute their success to God. So you generally do that. You're a very spiritual person?
Absolutely, yes. I know that you have to be, in my case, so yes.
And your father instilled some success principles in you when you were early?
Yes, we come from a very modest family from Mexico, and he worked very hard to get us where we're at, and because of him, my dad just passed away in February.
That's okay. We appreciate you sharing that. And if somebody is interested in coming to your beautiful spa, where can they find you?
We are located in Stone Oak, right here on 115 North Loop 1604 East, where the Mellow Mushroom and Kirby's area is at, and Narcotta Center.
And you also donated a raffle item, right?
Yes, for a color and cut style blondie.
Hey, girl!
But once again, thank you for being a part of this. It's so awesome to be surrounded by successful people who are so giving, like Veronica. Please give her a round of applause.
Thank you.
Our next speaker, for those of you who like food, comes from a very successful line of restaurateurs, right? And we have Miss Diana Barrios Trevino. Let me change the slide, sorry. To tell you about some of the success principles, because I'm sure you know a lot about success because you come from a very successful lineage, right?
And it's taken us a long time to get there. It's not something that happens overnight.
Yeah, success does not happen overnight. So please give Diana a round of applause.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I'm Diana Barrios Trevino, and my family is the owner of three restaurants. We have three family restaurants. Los Barrios is our original on Blanco Road, inside Loop 410. We also have La Hacienda de los Barrios, or La Hacienda de los Barrios, which is right down the street on Redland Road. In case y'all haven't been by, please come see us. And our newest restaurant is Violas Ventanas, named after my dear mother. And it's out in the Westover Hills community, out by SeaWorld. Beautiful area that is growing by leaps and bounds. If you haven't been out there, I invite you out there as well. My story, oops, I have a loud voice, so excuse me. I make this thing roar. Whoa. My story that I'm going to share with you tonight is the story that I lived, but it's my mother's story. And I believe that anybody can achieve anything based on her story. My parents met in the mid-50s at La Prensa. My father was a sports editor, my mother was a secretary. They met there, they fell in love, they got married. They had three beautiful children. I'm the baby. My mom became a stay-at-home mom. And when I was in second grade, she asked my father to buy her a restaurant. By then, my father was in Spanish. He had moved over to Spanish radio. And he stopped and he said, "You want me to do what?" "Yes, I want you to buy me this restaurant." He said, "No offense, your cooking is great." My dad was a portly guy. He ate very well. He loved your cooking. But he said, "What do you know about the restaurant business in general? What do you know about it? I mean, it's a lot of work." And she said, "You know, I come from a family of entrepreneurs and merchants. My mother was from Bustamante, Nuevo León, Mexico, which is close to Monterrey. And when her mother died at a very young age, my grandfather brought, she and her four sisters, there were five girls, brought him over to the United States because he felt this was the land of the opportunity that they would, that would help them, help him and help them. So when my mom, my father decided to buy her this restaurant, she went and boy, she gave it her all. She was so excited. That was in 1972. In 1975, my father was on his way to do a live remote for this radio station that he worked for. It was Labor Day Monday, 1975, and he was killed in a car accident by a drunk driver, leaving us all alone. I had just turned 12, my brother Louis had turned 15 that summer, and my sister was 16. We were very young, we were very sheltered and protected, very loved. Our life changed. Now, when my parents had us, they decided that we would be bilingual and bicultural. So we only spoke Spanish at home. Hence, my mother's English never really developed very well. She could speak it. She understood some of it. But when she spoke it, it was better that she didn't. So only because she had a very heavy accent. And sometimes, like if she said she wanted to go to the beach, it sounded like that word you were trying to say. And if she went to Dillard's to buy bed sheets, that was not a good thing either. But she knew her limitations, and that's something that's very important, that we should all know our limitations and be able to use our resources to find somebody that can help us, that can team up with us to get to where we need to be. So my mom kept that little restaurant after my father died for two more years. She sold it in 1977, got burned in two business ventures. One of those business ventures was a small table, white tablecloth South American restaurant that she had invested $10,000 in. This was 1977. And there was it was a really nice little restaurant. She didn't work it every day, but there was a maitre d' there who overheard her two gentlemen business partners trying to figure a way to swindle the widow out of her money, which was our college money, because it was a definite thing. There was no ifs, ands, or buts. We were going to college and beyond if possible. And so this gentleman came to my mom and said, "Hey, I just want you to know what's going on." Mind you, she'd already been cheated in another business venture that she and my father had invested in. And so, you know, they went to court, she won. They didn't have the money to pay her back, so, you know, that was that. That restaurant closed down. But that gentleman that approached her and told her what was going on came to her and he said, why don't you and I open up a restaurant? I have a lot of experience. You have a lot of great experience and great recipes and I can help you, you can help me. And she said, I just got burnt in this business venture. She'd also taken a real estate class. When she sold that first little restaurant, she decided she was gonna go sell real estate. She was very good with numbers. She was passionate about real estate. She loved it. So there she goes down to San Antonio College and she takes that real estate class and by golly, she's the best at it. She's very good. Well, you have to take an exam to get that license, right? To practice or to sell real estate, correct? Well, the class was given in Spanish, but the test was only given in English. Didn't work for her. What was she gonna do? So when this man approached her about opening up another restaurant, she said, what am I gonna do? I have to provide for my family. We were young. My father died at 46, there was no will, because he was very young. So he thought, never thinking what would happen, happened. So as you can well imagine, our life was turned upside down. But my mother thought about opening up this restaurant very hard. And she said, what am I gonna do? I didn't make it in the real estate, I've gotten cheated, and I can't afford to lose any more money. So she said to him, you know what? Yes, I will open up this restaurant with you, but I'm only willing to invest $3,000. $3,000, that's not a lot of money. This, of course, was in 1979. With the little money that he put in, they opened up Los Barrios. Now, they opened up on the corner of Avenue B and Jones, downtown, around the corner from the Museum of Art. It was an old boat garage. It was not pretty. There was no matching tables, no matching chairs. There was one door everybody came in and out of, from the vendors to the customers to the one employee that we had. And there was no parking. You parked on the street or there was just not a whole lot of parking. But like my brother Louis says, when the food is good, there was forgiveness and everything else. And people were very forgiving because after 3 weeks, it was standing room only. The landlord happened to live next door. Remember, my mom had just taken that real estate class, so she signed a short-term lease. Well, the landlord lived next door, and after 6 months, when her lease was about to expire, he said, Señora, I have to go up on the rent. And she said, okay, how much? And he said, well, it's going from $500 a month to $1,500 a month. He tripled the rent on her. She said, thank you, but no thank you. I want to own my own real estate. So she sent her family and friends out looking, and they found her the location where Los Barrios is at today, present day location, on the corner of San Angelo and Blanco. Now, if you go by there today, it's really, really, really pretty compared to the way it was when we got there in 1980. In 1980, my mom bought an old Dairy Queen. And if you walk into Los Barrios today, you walk in the room, or you walk into the restaurant, you go through the lobby, you get into the three dining room areas, or four dining areas that we have, and right in the middle is the original door jamb that still says 4223. From that original Dairy Queen, a very daily reminder of our very humble beginnings. That was in 1980 that she moved there. In 1981, top 100 restaurants in America in Esquire magazine. Can you believe that little converted Dairy Queen, Los Barrios, was in that magazine? Thank you. I just graduated from high school, but you know, it took our business to another level. We had to expand, and after, you know, the New York Times wrote about her and the Texas Monthly and all of these publications, the kind of advertising you can't afford because it's so big and it's so expensive, but they were blessings. That's the only way she could equate. How did this happen? They were blessings. And after 5 years, our business partner, who had never been involved in such a successful business, she and they decided to part ways. My mom bought him out and went off to run the restaurant on her own. But it was challenging, lots of challenges. And a couple years later, my brother came back to run the business, and she was very happy to hand over the reins. However, she was the backseat driver. ¿Por qué estás haciendo eso? Why are you doing that? And what is this you're doing? And I'm signing what? He's like, Mom, you have to let me make my mistakes. And that's how we have grown. You know, Louis was recognized by his peers as Restaurant Tour of the Year and Small Business Leader of the Year, but my mom was always there supporting us. And we have a great staff that takes very good care of our family And what I mean by my family is our customers. They're an extension of our family. Our employees, they're an extension of us. I mean, they are our family. After, I guess, 25 years being in business, we ventured out and bought this piece of property where everybody told us we were crazy, and we built La Hacienda on 5 acres, and it's beautiful. It is a beautiful restaurant, and 2 years ago, we ventured out to Westover Hills and opened up Violas Ventanas, and that is a tribute to our beautiful mom who left us way too early, way too soon. Like your daddy, my mother, I'm so eternally grateful for having lived this life with her, seeing her face all the challenges, all of the ups and the downs, the great things, the everything that has come our way. I'm so grateful because I was able to learn on a day-to-day basis. I would see her and I would see how she would accept these challenges and how she would accept the successes that went along with it. And I'm very, 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 very grateful to my parents that they, first of all, gave us a lifetime of love, and they gave us a love of our culture and the language, because that has opened up so many doors for us. I'm gonna be here, so ask any questions.
Well, we want you to remember, write your questions down, but I have the microphone, so I get to ask some questions. Now, I love flan, so I consider myself a flanosaur. I just made that up. You registered that. But I love flan, and I've never had your flan. Is it good?
It's delicious. But you know what else you need to try? Yes, it's mom's recipe, but you also have to try mom's empanada de guayaba with cream cheese. Oh, yeah, yeah.
I like the way that sounds. So delicious. Can you say it again?
Empanada de guayaba.
That's good. Awesome.
Well, it's the sweet empanada.
Something else you said that I absolutely love is that you followed your mom on this journey, or your family. So let me tell you something real quickly about me. My dad was a machinist, and he would commonly work day and work on cars at night. And one of the treasured memories I have was learning how to work on my car from my dad. And if you have kids, teach them the things that you do, because those are cherished memories, and these cherished memories that you have with your mom, teaching you the business, so it's very invaluable.
You know, it's great that you said that, because it brings up another point, and this is something I tell people all of the time. My brother took the business to another level, and then somehow I got in there and got involved, and because I have it in my blood, I do a lot of TV and radio and represent different companies in English and in Spanish, because I'm bilingual and bicultural, and I get hired to do that, which is great. I've worked with the Texas Beef Council, with Bush's Beans, and I've traveled and enjoyed it. But one of the very first national shows I got to do was Good Morning America from our Riverwalk. And it was with Emeril Lagasse. This was back in 1999. I was pregnant with my third son. I have three boys. And that afternoon, after it was all said and done, the food producer from Good Morning America calls me and says, Diana, I'm already on my way back, but I'm on a layover, and I just want to tell you my friend Pamela is going to call you. Okay. She saw you this morning on TV. Okay, why is she going to call me? And she said, well, she's an editor at Random House, and she wants to know if you would do a cookbook with her. Random House? Oh my gosh. My school books were by Random House. That Random House? That Random House. So 3 weeks later, we had a very thick contract. 3 years later, our cookbook came out. Why did it take 3 years to write a cookbook? Because like any good Mexican, Italian, Greek, Jewish, whatever ethnicity you want to say, nothing was documented. No, the way my mother cooked, it was not documented. Mira, cuando está así, le echas eso, un puño, nada más. When it's like that, you add just like a pinch. And I'm like, I need to measure that pinch, because that's what they told me. These recipes had better work. They will be tested and retested in professional kitchens. I'm like, oh yeah, this is not gonna work. So it took 3 years to document those recipes. So if anybody has a favorite recipe that you make, or that your mom, your grandmother, your aunt, whoever the cook is in your family, ask them to write it down, because it is a treasure that you will have for you and for your family for many, many years to come when that person is gone. So that is, thank you for reminding me.
Oh, thank you. And she donated a cookbook and a $20 gift card.
It's a cookbook, a $25 gift card with a tortilla warmer. It's the best tortilla warmer you'll ever
find. That is awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, Diana Barrios Trevino.
fourth prisoner, she already spoke earlier. That's because she is a San Antonio Masterminds member. Her name is Nerissa Figueroa. I don't know how to roll my R, so please don't judge me. But Nerissa is the owner and president of Stay Fit, Stay Fierce. She's a fitness competitor, model, and personal trainer. And I will tell you, she is my therapist because I hire her to help me lose weight, and she helps me 3 days a week, so she's my therapist too. Yes. Go ahead.
We're happy to have you here because she did hill sprints today.
Oh. I'm gonna sit down with that.
Thank you guys, and again, I'm excited to be here, and I've been in the fitness industry over 20 years, probably about 24. I started when I was very young, and I knew right from the get-go I wanted to be in fitness. I was a big tomboy when I was younger. My mom pretty much had to force me to wear dresses. I always wanted to wear jeans. I was always running outside. I was always trying to beat the boys in the PE all the time. So it's just fitness has always been my life. And I actually did property management for quite a while, and I did fitness part-time. And fitness always pulled me. And it always pulled me. So I became a certified group instructor in 1991 when they had the big slouch socks. We all remember those outfits back then. Everything was tight and shiny. And then in the mid-90s, I got certified as a trainer and started training. And again, it was still just a side thing, but it continued to pull me. And in 2001, 2003 actually, I had my son. But when I was in my 20s, I always watched ESPN and I always watched these women compete in the fitness competitions, doing their fitness routines and showing how hard they had worked for their muscle and so forth. And again, you always keep learning. And I sometimes was like, why can't I get to that point? I exercise, I do this. There's a lot to it. There's the exercise, the food, the discipline, all of it. Well, 2003 and 2005, I had my son, had my daughter, and then I started working for the Air Force in 2003. I was a health and fitness specialist, so I trained the airmen and women and did physical training for them. I worked with the community. I was a tobacco cessation specialist. I also did a lot of health fairs, diabetes, helped with our diabetes classes and cholesterol classes. And I did marine conditioning classes as well. So it's kind of funny because a lot of times when the airmen or the Marines or anybody would come in, because when we did physical training leaders certification, they'd come in and there was a lot of times these young people, men and women, and they thought, what's she gonna teach us? You know, she's like this tall and little. And I was always so, have to admit, I was a little happy when I would kick their butts. And I was beating them. I'm like, you're gonna let a mom beat you? And so that pushed them a little bit harder. So I went to a conference, and this is one of my, besides my children, but career-wise, one of my proudest moments was in 2007, my daughter was born in 2005, it was 2007, I attended a conference in Las Vegas, the American Council on Exercise. And if you attended the conference, it just so happened they were having the Miss Fitness USA competition, the national competition at the Rio. So I bought tickets. I had been watching this show on ESPN for so many years before. I sat in the audience. I sat to two other gentlemen that were with the YMCA. And watching them, it was beautiful watching the fitness routines coming out in their evening gowns. And they said, why aren't you up there? I wasn't in the shape they were in, the ladies on stage, but I told myself, why aren't I up there? There was doctors that were competing, there was moms, there was executives, all walks of life. So I went back home after my conference, and I said, that's it. I have my two kids, I wanted to do it in my 20s, but I wasn't disciplined enough, and now I'm gonna do it. So that was September of 2007. And I pushed myself and got into training with a coach. And March of 2008, I got on stage. It was a regional in the state in Arizona. I got second place. 2 months later, I went to Phoenix and I competed.
and I got first place, so I qualified to go to the national competition. So in 1 year, what I was so proud of is that I was sitting in the audience, and a year later I was competing on stage. So I was so excited because, again, I was... just a big accomplishment for me because I had my children, I worked full time. So it can be done, whatever goal you may have, whether it's a fitness goal, a business goal, it can be reached. And I worked for the Air Force again for 8 years, and I moved back to San Antonio, started working for the Valero Corporation as a health fitness specialist, and trained there, absolutely loved it. And then I also work for the Zachary Corporation as the health and wellness director. But my goal has always been to really do my own thing, just like everybody wants to do their own thing, because you know your worth and what you can do and what you're capable of. And if you push yourself, and as all these ladies said, push yourself and surround yourself with people and family. I'm very lucky to have my mom and my sister here supporting me here today. My mom, I'll tell you, She was a cement for our family, no matter what was going on. She always kept it together, managed 4 kids. You know, just like you're saying, Diana, you know, kids are running around and she's on the phone and so she comes in, you know, and yelling at us and cooking at the same time. So I don't know how she did it, because I have 2 kids and I'm like, I don't know how my mom did it. So she had 4 and worked, did everything. So she's pretty much my biggest role model, my mother. So I think if you look to family, look to your loved ones, look to those who support you. There was one person, and I remember what they said to me. They're like, why do you do these fitness competitions? You know, and that's when I had 1 second. And they said, you're not, you know, you may not win, you're not gonna win. And it just really got to me. Really, I was like enraged almost, but I was like, argh! And then I pushed myself, and that's when I was on the national stage. And I won Miss Fitness Arizona in 2009, 2010, and won the fitness championship in 2012 here in Texas. So I just believe in yourself, work hard, and you'll get there. Always believe, 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 believe. Thank you.
So this is, we're gonna take a brief intermission, about a 10-minute intermission bathroom break. Grab some waters, we have waters over there. Please write down any questions that you may have that you would like to ask these ladies. After the intermission, we are going to let you ask these ladies those questions. So, see you in 10 minutes.
Anyone else, real quick? You got 10 seconds. Okay, no? Okay, come on, real quick. The first one's gonna be a silk tie by HKD Custom, which you can get after the event.
Oh, you know what? Wait, before we draw this, I completely forgot to have HKD Custom. Susie, come up and tell us about your wonderful line of products, because we actually bought a t-shirt special for our friend Brian. They custom make these shirts, and they're phenomenal. This is all custom-made stuff. Susie Cabrera with HKD Customs. Sorry, I'm absent-minded. She's going to come tell us about your wonderful product, and thank you for being a sponsor. You help make these events happen.
Wonderful event. I feel so inspired from these ladies and everybody's stories. I really want to be a part of the San Antonio Mastermind. I feel so good.
You are part.
This just reminds me why I started my journey of my company 4 years ago. I moved to Hong Kong with the support of my mom, who's with me tonight. And when I was abroad, I started working over there because my major was in Chinese. So originally I was in Shanghai. And things did not go as planned. They hired me to be a translator, but the office didn't open up, so they said, well, now you're a factory inspector. So that was not very glamorous, but it was the best schooling I could have ever asked for, because I really learned about the production side. You know, I started to go to 11 different cities every month, inspecting different types of products, and it gave me a lot of confidence. And I said, you know what, why not do what I want to do? I don't want there to be a ceiling for me either, like she mentioned, and I really wanted to go for it. So I was really inspired by the Hong Kong British influence of the custom clothing, everybody in their business wear looking great, and I decided to pursue fashion, which is what I love. And so I started interviewing different tailors, and being a woman, it was very challenging. You know, they didn't want to work with me just for being a woman. and my age was not a great factor, even with makeup and hair done. Sometimes I look like I'm 15, so I really had to push for that look. And eventually I found the perfect tailor who was working with the Japanese and Italian market. And then I flew to Italy and found the suppliers I wanted to work with. 4 years ago, I launched it out of my house with the support of my parents again. And today we have a showroom. We recently won Best Menswear Designer here in San Antonio. And I'm just excited.
Thank you for coming. And if somebody wants to get in touch with you, they can just come by your table.
That's right. Yeah, please come by. I do. It's at hkdcustom.com, and we have a Facebook. But come by and say hi to me and my mom. We're over here.
Thank you, Susie. Susie is also donating a silk tie, which will be available to be picked up afterwards. And Blondie.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so here we go. This is for the silk tie by HKD Custom. You'll get after the event, and that goes to, if I can pronounce your name, Christy Summers.
Christy, she's always been. Okay, so after the event, get your custom card.
Oh, does she get this now, or do we have to draw this?
No, it's with the tie.
Oh, hey, you get this too, girl. Okay, so after the event, go talk to them. Okay, the second one is Veronica Spa and Color Co. I want this so bad. All right, get your hair did, ladies.
Me.
Elizabeth Thornton? Elizabeth Thornton? Where you at, girl?
Let's give this to Veronica.
The third one is for Patricia Czar's wine basket that she donated.
I like how realtors think they're bringing the wine.
Yes.
And John Chocolate.
That's not fair. Okay, Kirby Caden.
Kirby? He didn't leave, did he?
Kirby?
Must be present to win. I saw him earlier. Did he leave?
Yeah, he was leaving.
Should we draw another
going
one?
Once, going twice.
Going once, yeah. Going twice, okay. Iris Ramos.
Iris Ramos.
Ramos.
Yes. All right.
Yes.
Cool.
Get the wine basket.
Iris, you can get that.
Okay. This is for the custom cooked dinner by Chef John. This is for 4 people. You provide the food, and him and his crew will cook for you. So sounds like a hot date for me.
Wait, what's that? He'll buy the food.
Oh, my bad. Okay, here we go.
So yeah, dinner for 4, man. This guy's cooked for Kardashians, I heard. Don't hold against him.
Okay. You pronounce
it. Ivan
Regalado.
Now, before we move on to our question section, I want to acknowledge somebody who's one of the big reasons why I do this. Are there any November birthdays here? Raise your hand if you're a November birthday. Just two. Stand up if it's a November birthday. Okay. Devante works with Cheapo Signs. Pardon me. Cheapo Signs. If you ever need any signs done, go to Cheapo. The name is perfect. Devante bought 4 books, Think and Grow Rich, as a birthday present for people he didn't even know. So that's really, really awesome of you to do that. I would love for you to come up and give these out, Devante, to the birthday. Birthday girl, and you have a few extra. Thank you for doing this. This quality man, right? That's really awesome.
Oh, we have nobody birthday. Oh, cool. Alright.
There you go. Oh, awesome.
They're like, oh yeah, no.
Wait, the real birthday girl's over there. Oh, sure it is, yeah. Demonte, it's her birthday too. He's gonna. All right. Well, I think there's just one more, so awesome. We'll see Devante. Now, like I said, I hope that you guys are getting something of value from these things that we put on it. And just yesterday, we went to an event, and they did something that was, it really took me by surprise. I'd never seen this done before, and I've gone to a lot of trainings, a lot of seminars, and I kind of pick up some things. But I want to ask you to be a little bit vulnerable right now. I'd like to ask, we all have challenges, right? And I'm asking you to be vulnerable and be honest. Is there anybody here that's having a really, really hard day? Raise your hand. Really having a hard day? You being serious? You just want to get on stage. You being serious, right? Okay, come up here real quick. So they did this it was a seminar of about 700 people. And they didn't ask this person what challenge they were going through. They just said, hey, listen, who's having a hard day? And this lady went up and she was just vulnerable to this audience of 600 people that she didn't know. So this gentleman takes a lot of courage to do that. Tell me your name.
Porfirio.
Porfirio, cool name. So you're having some challenges, right?
Yeah.
So what they asked the audience to do, and I'm gonna ask you to do this too. I want you to pretend that your favorite celebrity is here. I want you to stand up and give Porfirio a roaring applause. Outpouring of love and thankfulness that rebounds and comes back to you. So hopefully that will make your day feel a little bit better. Thank you for being a part of this. Thank you. So now we are on to the question and answers section of the event. I want to thank you all for participating in this. And Blondie, please proceed with the first question.
Do you want me to go start? Okay, this is for all of you lovely ladies, and we'll start with you guys on this side. Did you ever feel, whenever dealing with a male vendor or a client or a contractor, that they, whenever you dealt with them, they would have preferred you being a male? Did you ever have that feeling, like, wow, like I can totally tell that they wish that I was a man right now?
Well, is this one? There you go. And, you know, I think that at the end of the day, we are the customer, right? They want the business, so you have to sometimes find the vendor that you might need to do with, that you might need to partner with, and that's the most important part of that is. You have to partner with them. You'll have to get along. They have to respect you. You have to respect them. And at the end of it all, it's a win-win situation for both parties. I mean, yes, it does happen, but you have to win them over and make sure that that kind of behavior goes away and that the winning, you know, relationship goes forward and takes you both to the next level.
Very well said. Veronica?
Yes, I've encountered that sometimes. I feel a bit like she said, you got to be confident and just do your part and not let that bother you. But I've felt that way a lot of times.
Yeah?
Yeah.
With hair?
Well, yeah, even with hair, with the vendors and all that. But it doesn't bother me. Like I said, you just got to be confident and go ahead and not let them know that you feel that way. Just be confident.
Patricia, with real estate, I'm sure it's a totally different.
Well, it's different. Real estate is one of the industries you actually do have a lot of females working in, and so it can be a little bit different. I know when I was starting off and I was in new construction, I dealt with a lot of subcontractors and, you know, superintendents and things like that. And at the time, I was mid-20s, I was 25 when I started, so I got referred to as little girl a lot, you know. So you just take it, you move on. But I think in business, you know, with anything, people want to do business with people that they know, like, and trust. So you've just got to overcome those things, you know. So obviously you do what you can to get in front of them, so you then know each other. Hopefully that, you know, you can find that you're in a position where you can make them like you. You can't make everyone like you, but once you've overcome that, then you simply just have to show them that you've got the knowledge, skills, and resources to get the job done for them. Show them that they can trust you, and then you can overcome it. So,
well said, Narissa.
Definitely have run into that, especially in the fitness, but even going out and about and dealing in certain services or whatever, I have felt sometimes where you may get treated differently because you're a female, but I agree, you have to be confident and you've got to stand firm. So that, I know when I was younger, again in my 20s, I probably wouldn't speak up like I do now, and now I definitely will speak up. I would say I'm opinionated, but if I want something done a certain way, that's how I want it done. And in my industry, without a doubt, you have males that sometimes want a male trainer. And working for the military, like I said, a lot of times, I'll never forget when I taught the Marine conditioning classes, it was an officer, a Marine officer that came to me, and they did a lot of CrossFit. And so when I was doing the conditioning classes, they weren't expecting, I guess, we're like, again, what is she gonna do? and so I made sure to make it extra hard. And they were extra sore, so that's how I deal with that issue.
Here's a question, and please forgive me if this is a stupid question. I know it's very easy to say that you're confident, but going back to what you said earlier, Narissa, with Jennifer Lawrence and the essay, I don't know if you guys read that essay that she wrote with Lena Dunham about men making more money than her in the Hollywood business. How do you overcome, what do you tell yourself, how do I explain this, to not come across assertive? Does that make sense? When you're trying to be confident and you want to say exactly what the male is saying, but they automatically take it as if you're being, you know, a brat. Am I making sense right now?
Yes.
So how do you, what do you tell yourself to get through that?
My biggest thing is I know my worth. I know what I've done. I know how hard I've worked, and I know what results I can get you and what I can do if I'm working with someone. This is what I can do for you. This is what you can do for me. Like Diana said, it needs to be a win-win. And if you work together, it'll be a win-win, but you do have to know your worth. And I will definitely tell you, when I was younger, I didn't tend to speak up. And that changes with experience, but if you can learn that when you're younger, learn it. It's much better.
I think just adding to that a little bit, obviously, as far as knowing your worth, make yourself worth more. Spend your time studying, learn more, you know, and then when you can take what you know and make them understand that you know that, they then see that you're actually worth it.
I like that. Thank you. Okay, so the next question, please bear with me, you guys.
Is right here. Next question is directed for Patricia Czars. And this is a good one. This is one that I would have written this. What are some of the tools or strategies you use to overcome procrastination? Don't procrastinate. Answer.
Being that I didn't prepare this at all until this afternoon. No. Now, that's a tough one. I mean, hand in hand with procrastination is a accountability thing. It's a time management thing. And when you're on your own and you are your own boss, that can be one of the biggest challenges that you go through is, you know, you're responsible for what you do. You know, so you want to hit the snooze button at your time? Do you want to, you know, get up and get your stuff done? So overcoming procrastination is just, I think it's kind of it's one of those things you just have to develop just like a habit. You have to break it. You know what I mean? So procrastination is a bad habit. And so if you just enough times remind yourself why you're doing what you're doing, force yourself to get up, force yourself to go on, force yourself to go, you know, one more step, whatever it is you're doing, then you realize that by not procrastinating, you can exponentially get farther and farther, and then it just becomes, you know, it's an opportunity cost. You don't want to lose it. And so you know that by not procrastinating, you're just going to get that much farther than whatever you're doing. So it's conditioning.
Cool. Awesome. Thanks.
Okay. I'd like to ask this question to Veronica and Diana. Who are some of your role models? Are there any books that you've read that really motivated you? Are there any speakers or people in your life that really pushed you, that got you to where you are today?
I want to thank my dad because I feel like he was the biggest role model in my life. My mom and the family, but really, it was a passion. I knew from when I was a little girl, this is what I wanted to do. So there was no magic to it because I love what I do. But what was the rest of the question?
Almost as if like you were your own motivation. Like, is there any, your dad was your role model. Was there any books or speakers, anyone else that?
I like to read a lot. And I don't have any specific names, but anything that's positive and motivational. I love to read anything, which is whether it's on Facebook, on Instagram, or books. I do like to read a lot, and I think in being around positive people, successful people, so that's my inspiration.
I love that. Thank you. Diana?
Well, obviously my mother was a huge role model for me, and she continues to be on a daily basis, and for reading material, scriptures, just the best key, the best resource, it's amazing. Sometimes I'll have scripture that pops up on my computer, and it's like, it is narrowing in on exactly what's going on in my life, and it, to me, I believe that it's a beautiful message that I'm not alone.
Awesome, yeah. It's funny in life how some of those things happen. There's a book called When God Winks, and some people call them coincidences, but these things happen in our lives. for specific reasons. My question is actually for Narissa, and it is, what motivated you to branch out and start your own business?
My biggest reason for starting my own business, and I would say my why, I always call it my why, is my children. I really, really want to spend more time with them. It started getting to me when my daughter would tell me, Mom, I really want you to come to my school to have lunch with me, or she was having an event for my son and I couldn't make it. And I just started seeing more and more that I was, not that working for someone, there's nothing wrong with it, except with me, I wanted to, as we all say, not really have a ceiling, be able to spend time with my children. I may not be yet where I want to be, but I know where I'm trying to focus on and where I want, you know, will be. So, without a doubt.
Okay, this is for all the mothers. Patricia, you're not a mom, correct? Okay. For all the other three of you guys, and I hope this makes sense. Was there ever a time that you experienced, like, you felt guilt for working for your dream and working, like, your passion and not spending as much time with your family? And how did you deal with that? Like, what could you advise all of us here and myself to, I guess, balance that?
You feel that way all the time. I know when they were little, I felt that way, but I've been blessed. I've had the same nanny since they were little, but it still feel guilty because, like Narissa just said, you miss a lot of events and all that, but you know it's all for them, and they understand it now that they're older. And you have to lead by example because as you get older, you want them to have that work ethic, and they always copy what they see. So for me, it's an experience for them, lead by example, and I know that they know that I love them, and they know that that's part of their success. So sometimes that's a sacrifice you have to pay for success, but they know I love them.
I agree 100%. I have three sons, and since they were little, you know, I had help during the week, or when they went off to school during the week, they were okay. But on the weekends, I still had to work. Weekends and holidays are very, very busy in our industry, and so they'd have to come with me, and I'd feel so guilty because they'd miss a birthday party, or my husband would have to take them, and they went in me, and it was hard. But they have learned that they're older now, and they understand it, and it's the work ethic. It's exactly what you said. They will copy you. And if there's one piece of advice I can give you is to teach your children to work. Tell them that they must start at the bottom, because when they start at the bottom, they can go up. If they start at the top, then they only have to go down, and that's not where they want to be. So.
Oh, that's a good one. Actually, did everybody answer?
Narissa.
Oh, Narissa.
Well, I just answered something sort of like it just a little while ago. They're my why. I do feel guilty sometimes. Sometimes I, you know, like she was saying, you could get help, you have someone watch them, but other times I want them with me, so there they go with me to the studio while I teach kickboxing, or there they go while I'm personal training, you know, running around and they're working out, and they know mommy has to work and she works hard, but they're also a part of my life, and they know what that fitness is a part of my life, like the restaurant business, the salon, everything would be a part of my life, becomes what the family pushes your family.
That's awesome. Thank you. I want to mention, guys, we got started a little bit late because of the rain. So hopefully, is it okay if we run just a little bit after? We wanted to try to wrap up by 9, but hopefully that's okay. If you have to leave, we understand totally. This question I found very interesting. And Veronica, you just gave the audience Ms. Butters, you gave the audience a bit of advice. But I'd like to ask all of you, what was some advice that you got that you felt helped you in your business?
Back to my mom. My mother would get always talk to anybody that wanted to talk to her, and they would come to her and say, "Oh, you're so successful. You've done so well. How did you do it? Tell me. Teach me. What am I doing wrong? What do I need to be doing?" And she would tell them, and I'm going to share this with you because it's very, very true. She said, "If I, who am not from this country, was not educated in this country, and barely speak the language, have been able to achieve what I have done, you're going to blow me away because you've had all those opportunities." And that's it. We have these opportunities, and we take them for granted. let's not take them for granted. Let's use our resources. Let's talk to those people that can help us and give us the guidance and you know, join the organizations. Give back. When you give back, it is amazing what you get in return, because there truly is, I mean, it's so much better to give than it is to receive. And when you start doing it, oof, it's an awesome feeling, and hopefully it's contagious.
She's right. I think we're in the land of opportunity, and when you come from another country and are able to succeed the way we have with a lot of hard work, everything is possible. You just gotta want it, and again, do everything with passion and a lot of hard work, and there's no impossible. We're in America, you know, you can do it.
Were you given some advice from somebody?
Yes, from a lot of people. Like I said, I know a lot of friends that own businesses, and I've always asked them questions and how they do it, and you'll get a lot of, why do you want to do it on your own? Why do you want to go off on your own? It's going to be hard work and all that. So, yeah, but you got to believe in yourself, and that's the key point. If you don't believe in yourself, nobody else will, so believe in yourself.
Patricia, what advice were you given that made you successful?
If I had to pick one thing, it would probably be, once I was told, trust the invisible results, because there are so much that you do when you're on your path to success or when you're working your day to day. You don't see results right away, and so many people stop and they try to switch gears and try to do something else, or they just don't see it through far enough. And you gotta trust the process. You gotta believe that the process is gonna work, and trust that everything that you're doing is adding up and that you're going to see results from it. I mean, they say that typically, you know, the results you're seeing today is a direct, direct result of what you were doing 3 to 6 months ago. So just stay on your track, you know, and trust that what you're doing is working, and stick with it, and then you will see results. So
that's great.
For me, obviously, again, my mom, I mean, she's always pushed all her children that they can do whatever they like, they want to do and really accomplish, always pushing for education. And I even remember when I was a little girl, I would dance around in the living room, I think with the broom or the vacuum cleaner something. And my mom would be like, what are you doing? And she's like, what do you want to do when you grow up? And I told her I wanted to be in show business. So I guess that's why I love speaking. I love doing motivational speaking as well. But to me, the biggest thing was always believing in myself, completely believing in myself. And I do surround myself with people who are positive, because even when I'm having a bad day, if I'm being grouchy or whatever, they help lift me. But I also want to hang out with people that they're pushing themselves. So it helps me tremendously.
Awesome. Good advice.
Okay, Ms. Patricia. What was the biggest challenge you faced, and how did you overcome it?
For the record, real quick, I'm going to clear something up. I did purposely wear the same thing that you said.
Yeah, you do.
Just to make sure that you knew. That was intentional.
Should have worn my blue dress.
My biggest challenge, I don't know, in the beginning, I hit on it a little bit before, you know, going out on I say my own, also my husband, but, you know, we were on our own, and that accountability there, that making yourself get up, making yourself take, you know, go take one more step and do that, initially, you know, was one of the hardest things, because, you know, a lot of people think they go on their own, and then they just, you know, the reason is, well, I want a flexible schedule, and this and that, I can do what I want. But if you're not really, you know, focusing on what your why is, and realizing that you've got to work very, very, very hard to do it, you're not going to get there. You know, I think a lot of people think they're going to have just this super flexible schedule, and they throw some work in there, and it's going to happen. But I probably worked twice as hard as I thought I would work going into business, with my husband and on our own. So the biggest challenge is just you gotta accept and acknowledge too that you're not gonna make everyone happy all the time. You know, so it's a big eye opener, because you get out there and you just want you know to be doing right in everyone's mind and doing exactly what everyone's wanting. But you can't please everyone all the time. So you just gotta figure out what's most important and focus on.
We have time for one more question, and this is actually directed to everyone on the panel. What do you say to yourself when fear sets in your job? Diana, you wanna, do you ever, you're so successful, you probably have fear all the time.
Who told you this? Oh my goodness gracious. You know, you can't be stifled with fear. You have to have a lot of faith. And my mother put all her eggs in one basket when she took that risk to open up that restaurant. And her basket was her faith. And you know, I've seen it my whole entire life. You have to have faith. You have to believe. You have to know that it's not all going to be hard. It's not going to be wonderful, wonderful, wonderful every single day. You're going to have your hills and your valleys. We've just gone through 3 years of road construction in front of Los Barrios San Blanco. That has been quite a challenge. And there's still construction, just not right in front of us. But, you know, we didn't say, oh my gosh, is this, you know, going to close our doors? Absolutely not. We, you know, we've struggled a little bit just to, you know, because they closed the street in front of us for a little bit, but we got it back open right away because we used all our resources. But that's what you have to do. You have to, you can't wallow in it. You have to just get up and go and look up, don't look down, and keep your head high and just, you cannot let fear take over because then you will crumble. It just won't work.
I feel like you always have to take chances in life, and if you're scared, you'll never know. So you have to do what you want in life, because you never know if you'll be here tomorrow. Just go for it, and if it goes wrong, there's another day, hopefully, to take another chance on the next project. But don't be scared, go for it, you'll never know. It usually goes fine if you're confident and you believe in yourself, so just believe and I think it'll be fine.
Yep. I think with fear, I guess it would depend on where it's coming from. You know, there's all kinds of fear. It can be fear that you're making a mistake, or fear that you're going too fast, or that things are around you getting, you know, too big too quickly. But so much, basically, I mean, anytime you're overwhelmed, it's probably just because you're underprepared. You know, so the more you can take time to focus and take time to learn and just broaden your knowledge on what it is you're doing, obstacles will be put in your way and they aren't as scary. You know, because you've already taken a little bit of time up front, to put that knowledge in your knowledge base, and then something comes up, and you simply just stop for a second. I always say take a deep breath. Don't ever jump into it. Just stop and take a breath and go, okay, I know this. I can get through this, you know. So you'll find out that you're a lot less scared and things are a lot less scary if you just spend a little bit more time, you know, on your day-to-day life, you know, preparing, you know, not preparing meaning that, you know, you're going to worry about everything that could come up. It's just, you know, filling yourself with the knowledge and, you know, that will lead to confidence and that will lead to being less fearful.
Well, for me, there's two things, and when fear sets in or doubt sets in, the first thing I try to think of, whether it's business or personal, is did I go through this before and how did I handle it? But the other thing is, I always tell myself when I really start stressing out about something or worrying, and it's like that saying goes, be a warrior, not a warrior with a W-O-O or W-O-R-R-I-E-R, and it's, if I've been through worse things beforehand, I'm going to be able to get through this. So I always look back at something where it was bad, and I focus on how can I be better. If I got through that, I'm going to get through this. And I maybe look back at how I did it. And then, of course, through prayer, I pray, you know, I have my faith. And even with my daughter, whenever she has a nightmare, I've always told her, when she has a nightmare and she wakes up, and she'll tell me, if she either comes to wake me up, or and we'll, you know, I'll put her in bed, or she gets into bed with me, I'll tell her, what do we always do when we have a nightmare and you get scared? And she says, Jesus, please take care of me. So I try to follow the same.
Awesome, cool. Well, to wrap it up, 30 seconds or less, any advice you can give the entrepreneur out here who may be struggling, just some words of wisdom.
Take every bit of experience that you can go through or learn or just go do it and just do it. That's just it. Just do it. And yeah, you might stumble, but don't worry, you pick yourself right back up, you dust yourself off, and off you go. And you will be amazed at all that experience. One day you go, oh, I can do that. Oh, I did that. Or let me tell you how, what not to do. You'll be the one giving out the advice.
Remember that positive attracts positive, so always hang around good people and just believe in your dreams and make them happen, because you might not get another chance, so just go for it.
Mine would be, and it kind of, you know, correlates with what I do, is treat it like a business. You know, don't get in there and think, you know, that you're going to grow a company or a business or even just become super successful in what you're doing unless you treat it like it's a business. It's not a hobby, you know, so it's, and don't be afraid to fail. You know, failure is part of learning and it's part of success of that, so.
For me, it's definitely believe in yourself and, you know your worth. Also, you know, don't listen to the negative naysay. You're always going to get negative naysayers without a doubt. And one of the biggest pieces of advice that I can give, that I've also been given, is don't just think of what can I do to be more successful? What can I do to be more successful? But also think about what didn't I do? What haven't I done? So not just thinking of what else you could be doing, but think of what did I miss? And that has helped me a lot.
Awesome, cool. Well, we're going to do our final raffle before we let these ladies off the stage, because they have actually donated some items. So, Blani, please come up. Let's draw. I think my favorite thing is the jewelry from Cassie, because I love her cufflinks. So our first recipient of Cassandra's collection.
Lisa Peterson?
Lisa Peterson.
I got your digits here.
Is she
here? Where you at, Lisa?
Lisa, oh, well, excellent.
Come on, girl.
Lisa. All right. You have So I have to announce, okay. Yeah, Cassandra collection, her necklace is right over there. Actually, you can go over there and see if you want. Our next item is a custom business card created by one of our founders, Peter Bichet with Boss Creative. Custom designed business card, plus $1,500, 1,500 cards printed. Now, you would be surprised. We did a seminar about business cards, and it's amazing how many people have bad business cards. Or their phone number's wrong, or their email's wrong, and that's really a lot of times your first impression. So, custom designed and $1,500 printed cards from Peter Bichet and Boss Creative, and Luz Moreno is our... Luz, is Luz here? Oh, excellent, Luz. Okay, let's see Peter. Our third item is that fantastic cookbook from the Barrio Enterprises. And do you say a $25 gift card? $25 gift card.
And tortilla warmer.
Melinda Martinez. All right. Oh, VIP. Nice. Awesome. You, and then, Narissa, you were going to donate a fitness package, right?
Yes, I am.
What exactly does that include?
The fitness package is a $150 gift certificate for either one-on-one or online training consultation.
Awesome. Come see me. $150 gift ticket from this. You can tell she works out.
To Blondie from KTFM. Just kidding. Here we go.
And that will go to Victoria Hayden. All right. And last but certainly not least, Lifetime Fitness, a 30-day pass by Brian Conway. Brian Conway donated that 30-day pass to Lifetime Fitness. And you already called Iris, didn't you?
Oh, yeah. Sorry, Iris.
And it is Luis Moreno. Luis Moreno. Well, awesome. No, Luis. Awesome. Christelle, two screen prints?
Yeah. So
awesome. So two screen prints. Go ahead.
Oh, my bad. Sorry.
I've been up since 3 a.m. Please bear with me.
And the screen print number one goes to Judy Mata, certified artist. Judy. And one more, yes. There you go. Yeah, sure, come on. Just don't trip, please. And our last print is for Maria C. Turbin. Maria? All right, that's it. Let's let the table. I did want to mention there's a table at the back, and I think somebody touched on it earlier, the Ferrari Kid. It's a nonprofit that's run by a gentleman named Manny Diot. Manny Diot was not expected to live past, I think it was 6 years old. He's had over 40 surgeries. He's in his 40s now. And he wrote a book called Happiness is a Pair of Shorts. And can you imagine being diagnosed at 6 years old and told you're not going to live to see seven? He's an incredible guy. He does an incredible organization. It's a nonprofit called the Ferrari Kid. And what they do is they get Ferrari owners to come pick up cancer victims' children. They take them out. They do the red carpet. They take them on a shopping spree. They feed them. And it's an incredible thing that they do. And please visit their table. They're also doing a raffle. We're going to have Denise come up and do their drawing. Denise, come on up and tell us what exactly you're drawing for the Ferrari Kid.
We've got two drawings, or two prizes back there. We've got a $300 spa package, and Full Prada Salon out in Sturgis has been very interested in partnering up with the Ferrari Kid. So they just came out with a new liquor. It's called the Moonshine. There's a strawberry and a peach flavored moonshine back there, and so that'll be the second prize. But we just wanted to say thanks for the opportunity. We believe in collaboration, not competition, so our charity is working hand in hand with a lot of other charities here in San Antonio, and we're just blessed to be able to do that. We feel that in order to be recipients of blessings, you also have to give. Everyone knows the law of attraction. Well, there's actually a law of giving and receiving. So if you ever want to learn how to develop philanthropy into your business model, we'd love to, you know, show you how you can do that. The best thing in life is to, everyone wants a life of significance, or I'm sorry, everyone wants a life of success. In order to have success, you need to have a life of significance, and we can show you how. So thank you.
I'm going to jump in real quick. One more thing with the Ferrari organization, because I'm on the executive board of directors. We have a big event November 20th at the Elan Hotel. It's a big casino night, and basically, obviously, it's one of our biggest events of the year where we raise funds for the Ferrari Kid organization. So if anyone is interested in any sponsorship packages that we do have available still for that event, or if you just want to get a ticket or anything, you can definitely contact me. And I can help you point you in the right direction to do that. But we've got a big, huge venue there and can support a lot of people. And obviously, the more people we get there, the more we can help the Ferrari Kids. So.
And our first winner is
Luis Moreno.
Man, Luis Moreno again. We had a winner at our last event who won like five things. It wasn't him. And our second winner?
Nancy.
Yes. All right, Nancy, thank you. Well, we want to thank everyone for coming out. Obviously, if you bought the VIP tickets, you're going to be able to sit and chat with these ladies after the event. We are also doing a toy drive, so you can find out about the toy drive on our website, samastermind.com, or you can speak to one of us afterwards. We could really use some help. We actually pay a lot of money out of our own pockets to put these on in the beginning, and thankfully for your donations and attending, it helps cover most of the costs. But we are looking for volunteers to help us. On December 8th, we're going to, at 6 p.m., is it still at the Elan? We're going to do our toy drive, and we want to give a big round of applause for these ladies and present them with a little special gift that we so appreciate their advice.
Today with our event. If you could please stand up, all our volunteers, our ambassadors, please, where y'all at? Stand up for the other ladies.
These are people that donate their own time to come help us. Thank you all for coming, and one more. Oh, that's right, Chris. Come on up.
be again. I know you guys are all anxious to get home. You've probably been away from home since like 6 o'clock this morning like me. But I just wanted to let you know about the Toy Drive. The Toy Drive is benefiting a nonprofit organization that Russell Groomer and I founded called Living Through Giving. It is an organization that helps children that are in the care of the Department of Family and Protective Services. These kids are, the last number I had was 8,914 children just in Bexar County do not have, they're living in foster care. So they've been removed from their home due to neglect or some other kind of issue with family and friends. My family has personally been affected by these kinds of like people making bad choices and their children being removed, excuse me, from their homes. So we want to invite you to come out. The cost of the event is actually just a toy donation to Living Through Giving. And it's at Elan on December 8th, 6 p.m. And I believe that they are gonna have some door prizes, some goodies, and we really appreciate as a mastermind coming, we really appreciate SA Mastermind giving us the opportunity to partner with them for this. So if you have any questions about that, you can find myself, Russell, or Heather back there, and we'd be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And if anybody's interested in being a sponsor of one of our events, please get in touch with us. It's hard to make these things happen, but you get a platform to talk about your business or your product in front of people that are serious about success and bettering their lives. Where else do you get a chance to do that? So if you are one of the VIP pays, we do have a room in the back. It's a game room where you get a chance to mingle with the ladies and ask questions. And thank you all for coming, and we look forward to seeing you at our next event. Thank you all very much.